Good morning. Welcome to church this morning. Granted to see you this morning. Those of you tuning in online, don't adjust your TV set. This is just what it's going to look like for the next 30 minutes. We're in the midst of that time of the year where the sun is just streaming in, and to be honest, I can't see any of you right now. So I'm just assuming that there's people here, and I'm glad you're together as we come together on this beautiful day. What a beautiful day that God's given us. Special welcome to those of you that are guests with us today. I'd like to see you later sometime when I'm not standing in the sunlight and meet you in face-to-face. But a special welcome to you if you're here for the first time or if you're gathering online for the first time. Welcome. A few announcements to draw your attention to. Reminder of our Lenten series called Stones. I want to encourage you to come and be a part of that on Wednesdays, either 12:15 in the afternoon or 7 p.m. In the evening. When you come in, you pick up a stone. And those stones are going to be useful for us as we get to Good Friday of Holy Week. And we'll talk a little bit more about that as we come together. Also, I have some bad news for you. Next week, if we spring forward. I feel the same way. All right. So next Saturday night, spring forward, move your clocks forward and so forth. And just to be sure that we can still gather at the right times, make sure that you do that. Also, we're taking orders for lilies and to celebrate Easter. This is a good Easter. We're going to gather together for Easter this year instead of last year, which was my wife and me and Megan. I think in the sanctuary, so it's good to be together. Maybe Will was with us too, but we're going to look at celebrating Easter, so if you'd like to be part of helping to beautify God's house, please be a part of that. Coming up in March 27th, we got two things we want to highlight. We'll put them on the same slide. In the morning, we're going to have a work day. Springtime's a great time to do some spring cleaning around here, and then in the afternoon, we're going to have an Easter egg hunt. Open for the community and things like that, a great opportunity for us to reach out with some of the goodness that God has blessed us with. So there's more information in the bulletin about that. Just wanted to put that so it's kind of on your radar, save the date, and recognizing the possibilities for us to come together as church. We are together as church. If you're online, put a little note underneath the video. If you're watching live right now, just say good morning so we know you're there. But let's hear today. Would you stand up, look around, give a smile, a wink, a wave, and wish everyone a good morning around you this morning. It sounds like there's quite a few people here, so this is good, right? Let's start a singing our opening hymn.
Thank you.
So we begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us make a profession of the faith that God has revealed to us, that He is triune, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we'll use the words of the Apostles' Creed, and you'll find those on the screens. Let's speak these words together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite the congregation to please be seated. As we have just professed the very identity of God, at least what we can understand, that God is triune, that God is holy, and that God is perfect. And when we recognize that God, even in our own human understanding, we come to realize who we are. And we are none of those things. And so we have an opportunity to confess our sin, to be wiped clean, to be washed. And so let's take up this opportunity to confess our sins. If you'd like, as a believer, let's take up the posture of a repentant follower of Jesus. Maybe slide forward where you're seated, holding your hands over the seat in front of you, speaking the words of confession you'll find either in the bulletin or up on the screens. Let us confess together with one voice. Please hear my confession, O God. I, a poor sinner, plead guilty before you of all sins. I have lived as if you did not matter, and as if I mattered most. Your name I have not honored as I should. My worship and prayers have faltered. I have not let your love have its way with me, and so my love for others has failed. There are those whom I have hurt, and those whom I have failed to help. My thoughts and desires have been spoiled with sin. Forgive my sin, O God, for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus. And so God has indeed heard your confession. And that's exactly why Christ came, to live, to suffer, and to die for your and my sin. But when He rose to life again on Easter morning, He declared once and for us all that sin is no more, that death is not the end, and the power of Satan is forever broken. So as God's spokesman to you today, I announce to you with great joy and absolute conviction in the promise and provision of God that your sin, my sin, all of it, is absolutely and completely forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please sit back for our first scripture readings.
Our first reading comes to us today from the 20th chapter of Exodus, starting with the first verse. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land of the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. This is the word of the Lord. Our second reading comes to us today from the first chapter of 1 Corinthians, starting with the 18th verse. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to the worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption, so that as it is written, let the ones who boast, boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand out of respect for Jesus and his word. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the second chapter. The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons, and the money changers were sitting there. And making a whip of cords, he drove them out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen. And he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of trade. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. So the Jews said to him, what sign do you show us for doing these things? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, it was taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Please be seated as we sing our next hymn.
Thank you.
Let's begin this time with prayer. Would you please bow your heads? Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we ask for your blessing, the blessing of your Spirit, the blessing of faith, the blessing of understanding and discernment, that you would grant us not only insight, but Lord, motivation to go from this place and continue to grow as your church. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. God's grace, God's mercy, and God's peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I'd like to direct your attention, as I always do, to the outline that is there in your bulletin. It's going to follow some fill-ins you'll see up on the screens. Maybe there's something in the message today, an unusual message, I hope, that gains a little traction as the days and maybe even as the weeks go on. There's no read and reflect in the bulletin today, those Bible readings that we invite you to participate in each day, because the Lenten devotionals are really meant to replace that. If you haven't grabbed one of those, there actually are still a couple of books back there in the back. So this morning we're going to focus on our gospel reading that Keith read just moments ago. So first things first, did Jesus ever sin? The answer is no. Right? If he had, the Bible is crystal clear. In James chapter 2, his brother, by the way. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become guilty of all of it. You see, if Jesus had given in to sin even once, it would have disqualified him as our Savior. And yet Paul says this in the second letter to the Corinthians chapter 5. For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And in 1 Peter chapter 2, talking about Jesus, he committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. So since the sinless Son of God, this clearing of the temple courts within the court of the Gentiles, was not a sin. Rather, it was righteous anger, a holy wrath for what was being done, and so therefore his actions were just. You see, every year, the Jews would celebrate their ancestors' rescue from the mighty hand of God when God sent 10 plagues upon Pharaoh and their oppressors there in Egypt. There were special feasts and worship times in the temple at Jerusalem, and Jews came from far and wide. And since these Jews came to worship from faraway regions and countries, the temple leaders in Jerusalem decided that they needed to standardize the offerings that were given at the temple, as well as a tax, which was required for every Jew. So the week heading up to the Passover, as travelers starting entering into Jerusalem to celebrate, money changers set up tables and booths in the court of Gentiles. Now, if faith were the temple in Jerusalem, where you walked in, if you walked in the main doors under the portico, that would be what would be considered the court of the Gentiles. Anybody could stand around and gather there. Once you come in the main doors, there in the lobby, maybe all the way to the place where the white chairs are in the very back, that would be where only Jewish men and women could gather, no Gentiles. You step into the sanctuary, if this were the temple, and only Jewish men could be in the sanctuary, not Jewish women. If you go all the way to the front up here, this is where the Pharisees would sit. Nothing personal, folks. Right? And then if this were the temple, there would be a giant curtain from wall to wall, from floor to ceiling, that would separate the people from the Holy of Holies at one time where the Ark of the Covenant would reside. And one priest, once a year, would go behind the curtain to offer up sacrifice for the people of God. So these money-changing tables and booths out there in the court of the Gentiles would be the first thing that people would see when they came onto the temple grounds. This is not the right picture for a place whose focus is the worship of God. Now, to help you understand the problem here, the money changers were exchanging foreign currency, most likely Roman money. Rome had conquered the entire region. And they were exchanging it for a special temple coin called a shekel. And the exchange rate was, to put it bluntly, not equitable. Kind of like if you go to buy a hot dog and a drink at Busch Stadium, you can get those cheaper in other places, right? And as those merchants are selling animals outside there in the court of the Gentiles for sacrifice, they were there because most of the priests would deny the animals that the travelers brought, claiming that their animals were blemished or somehow unacceptable, forcing the people that had traveled a great distance to worship here for the Passover to buy animals being sold out there, again, at exorbitant prices. You see, worship had developed an element of a money-making proposition in Jerusalem, and Jesus had had enough. And here is the lesson for us this morning. It's one simple word that we might overlook otherwise. It's poieo. It's a Greek word. In John chapter 2, Keith read this moments ago and says, so he made poieo, a whip out of cords, and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. Poieo. It means to make. It means to create or to construct. Here's what I want you to understand this morning. Jesus took time to make a whip. He didn't just walk into the court of the Gentiles and have a temple tantrum. Sorry, I couldn't pass that up. As some movies would have us believe. He likely had seen this behavior in his past visits to the temple to celebrate Passover for 30 years. Maybe it had gotten progressively worse in the temple. But now, his public ministry had begun. Now he had disciples to teach. And here was an important opportunity to teach about righteous anger. And it's an important lesson for us of what we are to do when we're angry and upset about something important. So maybe Jesus took a cord from some of the nearby animal pens and talked to his father. He said, Father, how do you want me to respond to this? I mean, they're exchanging money here in your house. They're selling animals here in your house. They're taking advantage of your people, and I know how you feel about this. How do you want me to respond? What do you want me to do about this? This is supposed to be a house of prayer, and they have made it into a den of thieves. How seriously do you want me to take this? What do you want me to do? Jesus' response wasn't rash. Jesus' response wasn't purely emotional. Jesus' response wasn't without the approval of the Father. And so he chased out the money changers. He chased out those that were exchanging animals. He chased out everything that was in the way in the court of the Gentiles that made it into a marketplace. And he did it with authority, and he did it with a whip. Now you and I, we shouldn't be surprised at Jesus' reaction at the temple courts that day, because Jesus came to bring division. You see, when a holy God comes to live among a broken people, his holiness acts like a sword. In fact, when Jesus was just 8 days old, his mother and father, Mary and Joseph, brought him to the temple in Jerusalem to be dedicated. And Simeon took him up in his arms and he said these words to Mary, Luke chapter 2. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed. And a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. And so Jesus does cause the rising and falling of many. That's his holiness. And he will judge the world. In fact, this is what Jesus said of himself in Matthew chapter 10. Do not think that I came to bring peace on the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. And soon, just like upon the moment of Jesus' death on the cross, the curtain in the temple I was talking about before, which separated the people from the presence of God in the Holy of Holies, was torn in two from top to bottom because it was in the way. It was a barrier between us and God. And so these merchants, this mentality, this menagerie was in the way. And it had to be removed. And so here's, church, where we come in. Believers in Jesus should cause the same reaction. You see, if Jesus lives in us, if we seek to follow him, if we want to walk in his steps, then we too will cause division with anything and anyone that is a barrier to a God that loves them and those that God has called to join his kingdom. And so we are called to often take up the tools of division. Not swords per se, but figurative whips to chase out what doesn't belong. Barriers to a relationship with God through Jesus. So what are we to do when we encounter those important things that make us righteously angry? Those things that oppose the plans and the path of God. What should we pay attention to when it comes to making our whips? Well, following Jesus seems to be a good start. Take your time. Poieo. Take time to make the whip. Spend time thinking, processing, planning, and most importantly, pray. Give the Heavenly Father every opportunity to steer you in your response to what has made you angry and what has made him angry. Give him every opportunity to speak through you in your response. Remain his witness in this world. And give yourself time to react in a balanced, not a purely emotional way. And like Jesus, stand for the truth. You see, what was happening in the temple court that day was wrong. This was not just simply the opinion of Jesus, it was wrong. People were being led astray in a dangerous way. Instead of focusing on God's rescue many years ago in Egypt. And the God that rescues them still was the one holding the whip. And if your anger is a just anger, then it must be God's truth that we use to measure against the offense. See, the issues of abortion and abuse and human trafficking and pornography and addictions and divorce, God speaks to every single one of those and many more. But God's truth is meant to bring division. Because if we persist in sin, we could be eternally separated from God. Paul's letter to Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 7, it says, "For even if I made you grieve with my letter, I do not regret it. Though I did regret it, for I see the letter grieved you, though only for a while. As it is, I rejoice, not because you were grieved, but because you were grieved into repenting. For you felt a godly grief, so that you suffered no loss through us. For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death." And because this is the danger, 1 John 1, it says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. And if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So as we go about, church, as followers of Jesus, bearing whips for Christ, we must be vigilant in this way. Make sure that it's Jesus that offends people and not us. Don't brandish a whip when someone's political views don't agree with yours. Or if their job choices are different than yours. If their pastimes and hobbies are different than yours. If their purchases are different than yours. If their church or worship style or denomination is different than yours. Leave the whips at home. You see, Jesus' holiness is what brings division. And his intention is to bring life through it. And church, know this. Anything between God and us, Jesus paid for. Now, Satan will lie to us about how immovable those sins are in our lives, in these temples. But the Son of God, the Messiah, he died to remove those sins. And it's not because you and I have been good enough to warrant his love. He offers it freely to all those that trust in the gift of grace and the promise of life in him. But church, I want you to know, if there is a persistent sin in this temple, he will aggressively remove it. He loves us too much to tolerate anything getting in the way. So as we address the sins of the world around us and in each other as God's witnesses, take time making the whips. Make sure that you stand firmly upon the truth of God and make it your goal to draw people to God and to chase away everything that gets in the way. In the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. In our prayers this morning, I want to add one more prayer to it. I want to celebrate today for Paul and Brenda Rathman, who are celebrating their 35th wedding anniversary tomorrow, I believe. And we want to thank God for that and celebrate that as well. Following each of our petitions today, I'm going to speak the phrase, Lord, in your mercy. I'm going to invite you to respond, hear our prayer confidently, knowing that God hears and answers according to his will and his timing. Following the prayers of the people of God, we'll pray the Lord's Prayer. And if you need those words, they'll be located on the screens for you. Would you please stand? Let us go before the Lord in prayer. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for the gift of your truth, for the calling of your church. Lord, when I think of all the struggles that are happening in our world right now, in politics, among people groups, in different countries, and the unrest that is out there, it is simply because of sin. And the reason that sin takes root in all of the lives of people is because we allow it to. So Lord, help your church, embolden your church, grant us the courage and the boldness and the love to be able to speak truth into this world in a winsome way, but not to recoil away from the sin and the evil in this world, but to confront it by taking the time to make whips of your truth and your love. He saved people, our Lord, when he went into the temple that day. to just take away the distractions, to take away the reasons that would draw away from himself and the grace and love that he offers. Lord, use us, I pray, as your church. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for those that are in need of your help and healing today. And so I lift up to you Martin and Regina and Paul and Ken and Jean, Quinetta, JR. Lord, those that are on our hearts that continue to heal and mend. I pray, Lord, that those would continue according to your will and your timing. Lord, that you would encourage all those that we know that are struggling, whether it's physically, mentally, spiritually, emotionally. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, I pray for Julie, lost her mom this last week. I pray for friends of Cliff, Jean Parker, lost her husband Pat. Lord, I pray that you'd grant them all comfort in the midst of the sadness. Lord, we have sorrow when we lose those we love, but I pray because of you, we have hope. Hope in the resurrection of all those that know you and trust you. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, I pray a prayer of thanks for Paul and Brenda. Lord, we celebrate with them 35 years of blessings and experience and an example. Lord, continue to rain down upon them your goodness and your gifts. And Lord, may their marriage continue to inspire others. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, I pray for this country of ours. I pray that you continue to protect those that protect us. Lord, use us as your church to be those voices, to speak your truth, and to rid this world of sin around us. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, all these things I ask in the name of Jesus, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us prepare ourselves to receive the very presence of Christ here in this meal. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. So in this meal, Jesus makes this simple but profound promise that his very body and blood is truly here in the bread and the wine. And through this meal, God grants us his grace once again. If you share this belief with us, this is not simply symbolic or a representation of Christ, and come forward and receive the elements of communion and the blessing to follow. But if you have a different set of beliefs, different church background, maybe you still have questions about what this meal is all about, I would like to still invite you to come forward to receive a blessing. So if that describes you today, I'd ask as you come forward to fold your hands to signify to me. We recognize that Jesus does indeed meet us here in this meal. And so our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Thank you. Please be seated. Congregation, please stand. And now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you all to life everlasting. Receive now the blessing of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Invite our congregation to please be seated. You'll be ushered out starting from the back to the front. May God bless you this week.